sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I close my eyes, and I'm floating in love. And I close my eyes, and I'm drowning in sorrow. And I close my eyes.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to another episode of our series, Sirat al-Rasul, Lessons and Morals. I'm your host, Yasir Qadhi. In today's episode, we will discuss one of the most marvelous and fantastic incidents in the Sirah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the incident of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. Now, the incident of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj is actually two incidents, the incident of Isra and then the incident of Mi'raj. But because they occurred back to back, one after the other, on the same night, they are always discussed together. But in actuality, they are two separate incidents. The first of these incidents, Al-Isra. Al-Isra means the night journey. Any journey that is done at night is called Isra. And this is the night journey that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did from Mecca to Jerusalem and then back again. This is Al-Isra. Al-Mi'raj means that which takes you up. And the Mi'raj is something that occurred from Jerusalem that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was taken up to the heavens. So Al-Isra, Mecca to Jerusalem. Mi'raj, Jerusalem to the heavens. And then back down and then back to Mecca. Because as we said, the two incidents occurred back to back, one after the other, they are always discussed together, the incident of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. This incident occurred 1 year before the emigration to Medina. In other words, it occurred towards the end of the Meccan era. This miracle is mentioned in the Quran. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises himself because of this miracle. In the beginning of Surah Al-Isra, an entire chapter called Surah Al-Isra, Allah says, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi. May Allah be glorified because he has taken his servant on a night journey. So Allah praises himself and says that he is worthy of being praised because of the incident of Al-Isra. The incident of Al-Mi'raj is referred to in Surah Al-Najm, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whatever he saw in truth, it wasn't a lie. And indeed, وَلَقَدْ رَأَى مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى. Allah says he saw the greatest and the grandest signs of Allah. So Allah described the signs that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw as being of the greatest of Allah's creations. This incident is reported in vivid detail in the first person because the Prophet ﷺ went alone. Our only source of information is the Prophet ﷺ. There were no eyewitnesses. So every report that we have, it originates from him. And it is reported in many, many different ahadith. Scholars of Islam have pieced together the incident from all of these ahadith. And in today's episode and also in the next episode, because it's a very long talk, we will, inshallah ta'ala, summarize this incident in chronological order and also mention some benefits and some wisdoms we can extract from this incident. This incident begins in the very Kaaba itself, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sleeping in the Hatim, in the semicircular region that is connected to the Kaaba and that formed original part of the structure of the Kaaba. We call this in Arabic Hatim. The Prophet ﷺ was sleeping over here at night when Jibreel came to him and woke him up and asked him to come with him. And before he did so, the Prophet ﷺ said, Jibreel opened up my chest and took my heart out and washed it in a golden bowl that was filled with Zamzam. And he put it back into my chest. So the Prophet ﷺ's heart was washed. And this washing had occurred before as well. Way before, many years ago, when the Prophet ﷺ was a child. It was reoccurring now at the incident of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj because the Prophet ﷺ was about to go on a journey that no human being had ever gone before. So his heart needs to be fortified. His himmah, his courage needs to be increased. His iman needs to be strengthened. So by washing the heart of the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ is being prepared to go on this miraculous journey. Jibreel then took him out of the Hatim and told him to mount an animal. An animal was brought, and the animal has a name. It was called Al-Buraq. And the Prophet ﷺ said it was a whitish animal. In other words, the skin color, the fur was white. It was above the size of a donkey, but smaller than a mule. In other words, the Prophet ﷺ is describing it. Larger than a donkey, but smaller than a mule. So it's not as large as a horse. It's smaller than a horse, but it's larger than a donkey. And what is special about this animal, al-Bura? The Prophet ﷺ said it puts its hoof where its eyes can see at the end of the horizons, all the way at the end of the horizons. That is one step. And the next step is the end of the next horizons. So it goes each step as far as the eyes can see. So it traverses a huge distance in a very short span of time. And there is no authentic hadith that mentions that Buraq had wings. This is something that we find mentioned in some of the books, but there's nothing authentic mentioned that. Rather, it is a physical animal that manages to leap as far as the eye can see. And the Prophet ﷺ was given this animal, and Jibreel handed him the muzzle of the animal. The muzzle or the reins are that which controls the animal. It is tied to the head of the animal. And so the Prophet ﷺ took the muzzle, and this animal, Buraq, it reared upwards, as any animal does when it sees a stranger, when it sees a person it has never seen before. It reared upwards. At this, Jibreel patted it and said, "O Buraq, are you not ashamed of yourself?" In other words, what are you doing? No person has ridden you that is more noble than this rider, meaning the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This shows us that Buraq has been ridden before. By whom or by what, we do not know. So al-Buraq calmed down, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam rode on it, and they went to Jerusalem in a few seconds. You can imagine, literally faster than a train, faster than a plane, faster than a jet. This is how fast they got to Jerusalem, within a few milliseconds, because every foot of Buraq, it goes as far as the eye can see. And within a few seconds, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived in the holy city of Jerusalem. And there the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "I dismounted Buraq and I tied Buraq to the post that all the prophets would tie their animals to when they pray at Jerusalem." Now realize, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that all of the prophets from the time of the Prophet Ya'qub alayhi salam and Ishaq all the way to the Prophet Isa alayhi salam, they venerated this mosque of Jerusalem, Masjid al-Aqsa, and they prayed towards it, and they considered it to be the holiest of mosques and lands. As for Mecca, the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam had built the Kaaba, and it was venerated and respected by Ismail and his children. But Ishaq and his children, they venerated the Masjid al-Aqsa. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was brought to a masjid that was considered holy and sacred by hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of prophets and millions of people who believed in Allah and the previous prophets. They considered Baytul Maqdis and Jerusalem to be holy. So, and it is indeed the third of the holiest places for us as Muslims. So the Prophet ﷺ was brought here, and he said, "I tied al-Buraq to the same post that all of the prophets would tie their animals to. And I prayed two rak'ats inside this masjid, the Masjid al-Aqsa. I prayed two rak'ats, and then when I turned around, lo and behold, I saw all of the prophets in one line behind me. All of the prophets were praying behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. 124,000 of them. They were all in one line behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this was done in order to show a number of things. Firstly, to show the finality of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that this is the end of all of the prophets. And secondly, to show his superiority to all of them, in that he is the seal of the prophets and the best of the prophets and the leader of the prophets. He is the imam of the prophets themselves. All of the prophets pray behind our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to show his rank and status in their eyes and in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and indeed in the eyes of all of mankind. He is the leader of all of the righteous, and he is the leader of all of the children of Adam. We need to take a short break. Stay with us. We'll come right back and continue our story of Al-Isra wal Mi'raj. Welcome back. We were talking about Al-Isra wal Mi'raj, and we mentioned that the prophets, all of them, prayed behind the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came outside, Jibreel came to him and presented him two containers, one of them with wine and the other with milk. And he said, which of these two do you want? And so the Prophet ﷺ realized by this time, wine had not been forbidden. At this point in time, there was nothing that prohibits wine in Islam. It was still early on in the Meccan stage. Wine is prohibited in the Madani stage. At this point, there is nothing that tells us that wine is haram. So the Prophet ﷺ has presented wine and milk. And he has asked, which one does he want? So he chooses the milk. And Jibreel says, you have chosen the pure one, the fitrah. You have chosen the right decision. This is the right decision. Because milk fills you up and it is unchanged. As it comes from the animal, it comes to you. Milk acts as a food and a drink. The only drink that gives you nourishment like food does is milk. Wine, on the other hand, is corrupted. It is taken from something natural, but it is fermented and it becomes corrupted. Wine, on the other hand, intoxicates and it does not nourish. And so by choosing the milk, the Prophet ﷺ is showing his own purity and the purity of those who believe and follow him. That they are following the original, the uncorrupted. Whereas wine is corrupted, milk is pure and uncorrupted. At this, Jibreel then took him up on the journey of Al-Mi'raj. Al-Isra is to Jerusalem, Al-Mi'raj is to the heavens. And Jibreel took him up via the Mi'raj, using the Mi'raj. What is the Mi'raj? It is an instrument that is used to transport people to the highest of heavens. Who has used it before? Allah knows best, we do not know. All that we know, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used Al-Mi'raj to go up to the heavens. There are seven heavens. Now, brothers and sisters, many Muslims get confused. These seven heavens are the seven skies. They are not the Jannah. They are not the gardens of paradise. These are physical skies. The Jannah occurs in the highest of heavens. The highest heavens occur, that is where the Jannah is. عِنْدَهَا جَنَّةُ الْمَأْوَى. Allah says, that is where the Jannah is. Jannah and the seven skies or the seven heavens are separate. Above us, there is the sky of this world. This is all that we know. All of the stars and the planets and the constellations, all of the galaxies and the solar systems, everything that we know around us. This is just the first heaven. Above it are six more, total of seven heavens. And Allah knows what they are. Our knowledge of science and astronomy, it stops at the first heaven. And even this, we do not know everything of it. What is beyond in the second and third and fourth and fifth, only Allah knows. And as for the Jannah, as for the gardens of paradise, that occurs in the final heavens, the highest of these seven. And even these Jannahs are many, many levels. So don't get confused between the Jannah and between the Samawat. The Jannat are the gardens promised to the righteous, and the Samawat are the heavens or the skies above us. And the Prophet ﷺ went through the Samawat and he saw the Jannat, and then he came back down to this earth. So he went through the seven heavens, one after the other, and he was with Jibreel alayhi salam. Every time they came to a heaven, Jibreel alayhi salam would knock on a door, and there would be a gatekeeper from behind the door, and the gatekeeper would say, who is it? Jibreel would say, this is Jibreel. The gatekeeper would say, who is with you? And Jibreel would say, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The gatekeeper would say, has he been sent for? Jibreel would say, yes. Then the door would open. So notice, each of these heavens has a door that is locked. And there is a gatekeeper behind the door. And the gatekeeper has some method of seeing who is behind it. Maybe something that they see behind the door. And the gatekeeper is asking, who is it? So he needs to recognize. Now angels cannot lie. So when Jibreel says it is Jibreel, that's all he needs to know. The gatekeeper sees someone else. He says, who is this? Jibreel says, it is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The gatekeeper asks, has he been sent? He needs to know. It is his job to make sure nobody goes unless Allah has permission. So he asks the angel. Angels do not lie. And so Jibreel says, yes, he has been sent for. So the gatekeeper opens. And the same thing happens in the first and the second and the third and the fourth and the fifth and the sixth and the seventh heavens, one after the other. Every time the gatekeeper stops, opens, closes, and lets them through. And then, when they enter the heavens, these are the heavens, the Samawat. Every single time they enter a heaven, there is a prophet there to greet and welcome them. So the first heaven is the Prophet Adam alayhi salam. The Prophet Adam alayhi salam says, Marhaban, welcome, O noble prophet and O noble son of mine. Because Adam is the father of all of mankind. So he welcomes the Prophet ﷺ and he says salam to him. In the second heavens, he met the Prophet Isa ﷺ along with his cousin Yahya. Isa and Yahya were cousins. And he met them and they greeted the Prophet ﷺ. in the third heavens, he met the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, and he described the Prophet Yusuf, and he said, it was as if the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam was given half of all beauty, meaning that Allah Azza wa Jal divided beauty into two halves. Half of it he gave to all of mankind, and one half of it he gave to the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. The fourth heaven, he met the Prophet Idris alayhi salam. In the fifth heaven, he met the Prophet Harun alayhi salam. In the sixth heaven, he met the Prophet Musa alayhi salam. And in the highest heaven, the seventh heaven, he met the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. And when he met the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said, the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam looks just like your companion, meaning himself. He looks just like me. And he also said, when he met the Prophet Musa alayhi salam, that the Prophet Musa alayhi salam welcomed him and greeted him, and then he began to cry. He was asked, why are you crying? He said, this young man has been sent after me, and yet he shall have a larger ummah than me, a larger following than me. So Prophet Musa alayhi salam was jealous in a good way, in that this man has been sent after me, but he will have more following and larger ummah than me. And he saw the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, and the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam welcomed him and said, this person, meaning the Prophet ﷺ, is the most closest in resemblance to him. And the Prophet Ibrahim welcomed him and said, welcome, O noble Prophet and O noble son. The only two people to say, O noble son, were Adam and Ibrahim. The rest of the Prophets were not ancestors of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Neither Musa, nor Isa, nor Idris, these were not direct ancestors. The only two direct ancestors, of course, Adam alayhi salam, the ancestor of all of mankind. And of course, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he is the founder of the, not just the Arabs, but also the Jews. Because one son of his, Ismail, is the founder of the Arab nation. And another son, which is Ishaq, he is the founder of the Jewish nation. And so the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam is the direct ancestor of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send these prophets to these heavens? In order to welcome our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When a guest comes, when a dignitary comes, you go to the door to greet him and you welcome him. So at each and every heaven, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the best prophets as welcomers to welcome the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this does not mean, by the way, that this is a hierarchy, that just because Idris comes in number four means he is better or lower than Isa. This doesn't mean that. Rather, every single prophet was sent to welcome him at a specific level. And just because one was in number four or number three doesn't mean they are higher or lower than the other ones. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam talked with some of these prophets and messengers, and some of these conversations he passed down to us as well. He then moved higher and higher until he saw two great things that he described to us. The first of these things he saw, he said, it is the tree called the Sidratul Muntaha. It is the lot tree. Sidratul Muntaha. What is this lot tree? The Muntaha means the farthest, and the Sidra means the lot. So the lot tree is the farthest tree that we know of. And it is called Sidratul Muntaha. The Prophet ﷺ told us why. He said, this is the end of the seventh heavens. Nothing goes beyond this. Everything that comes up stops here. And everything that descends down of the mercy of Allah starts over here. So this is a huge tree, a lot tree. The Prophet ﷺ said, its leaves are like the elephant ears, and its fruits, the lot tree, the fruits are like huge jugs that are common in Yemen. The Yemen jugs, they were Yemenite jugs. These jugs were larger than a human being, huge jugs of water. He said the fruits of this tree are like these jugs of Yemen. And he said it had different colors on this tree. I do not know how to describe it to you. In other words, colors that we don't know of, colors beyond the colors that we know. This tree is a huge and magnificent tree. It starts in the sixth heaven, and it goes all the way to the seventh heaven. And from the base, the root of this tree, four rivers flow. The Euphrates, and the Nile, and the Salsabil, and the Kawthar. Four rivers, they originate. Two of these rivers are rivers of Jannah, the Kawthar and Salsabil, and two of these rivers, they find their way down to this earth as well, in a way that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And the Prophet ﷺ also saw another great thing called Al-Bayt Al-Ma'mur. البيت المعمور, if you like, this is a type of Kaaba for the angels. We have a Kaaba on earth, the angels have something in the heavens, it is called البيت المعمور. And البيت المعمور, it exists above the Kaaba on this earth. And it is something that the angels go and visit. They visit it each and every day. 70,000 angels go and visit Al-Bayt Al-Ma'mur and they do tawaf around it, just like on this earth mankind does tawaf around the Kaaba. And 70,000 angels come every day, and then the Prophet ﷺ said, every one of them, they only come on that day. On the next day, a new batch of 70,000 comes, and they will never come again. And then the third day, another 70,000. And this has been happening since the beginning of the creation, and it will continue to happen until Allah knows. And if you just do a bit of simple math, after a while you start losing track of the numbers. How many are the angels that have come? How numerous are their quantity? After a while, the mind cannot proceed anymore. And we just have to say, as Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ. Nobody can count the number of angels other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he then went higher until he even heard the writings of the pen. The writings of the pen of Qadr. Allah created a pen that writes everything that has happened and is happening and will happen. And that is the pen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by in the Quran, wal qalam. This is the pen that Allah created. The first thing that Allah created was the pen. The Prophet ﷺ rose to a level that he could hear the writings of the pen. And then he rose to a level that no created object has ever been to before. So much so that even Jibreel alayhi salam had to stop and could not go any further. And only the Prophet ﷺ ascended even higher. And he ascended directly in the very presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to a place, to a level, to a station that no created object, not even an angel, not even Jibreel himself, not even the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam has ascended to a level where there was a direct audience with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke with him one-on-one, directly, without any intermediary, without any angel. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala held a conversation with him. And this conversation, we do not know any of its details except for one. And that detail was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obligated upon the Muslims that they must pray 50 times a day. It is also narrated that the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, they were revealed at this time, in other words, without any intermediary. This is one opinion of the ulama, that these two verses, they were recited directly to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam without any intermediary. These two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I was given it from under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that this is of the treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he was given, and no other prophet was given this thing before him. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obligated upon him that he tell his ummah to pray 50 times a day. What happened after that, and how did the 50 get reduced to 5, and how did the Prophet return to Mecca? All of this insha'Allah ta'ala we will discuss in part 2 of this series, where we will continue our discussion of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. I hope to see you in our next episode. Until next time, may Allah Azza wa Jal send His blessings upon all of us. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.